All right, so what you're gonna see is this very cut down reaction to the movie Uncharted. Now, this is my attempt at video journalism, basically, is what it is. It is a reaction. However, I do give very thorough points of view on what's being showed, or at least little pieces of clips that they can tie in to the overall broader scope of the movie itself. This is one of those movies that I didn't have a lot of expectation for going forward, but only because I didn't really play the video games. They used somebody, Tom Holland, who has recently just took and come off of playing Spider-Man. So it's really hard to take and actually, for me, I was like, that's kind of a little bit too close together, taking and playing, not so much a similar character because Spider-Man's a lot different. He's a superhero, but at the same point in time, taking and playing a role of a character that, number one, I think is a little bit older as far as the video games are concerned, even in the very first video game. And then having Mark Wahlberg, who is, despite the way he looks, is much older, but playing, just a little bit older of a adventurer who basically finances the whole thing. So there's a lot of tropes and everything like that, a lot of movies that have that are adventure, action adventure that they fall into. So I didn't really have a whole lot of hope that this was going to be some overly grand movie or, I figured it'd be more CGI and stuff like that. I come away pleasantly surprised. So here's a reaction, and at the end, you'll take in here where you can go to see the actual full reaction. So, all right, something a little bit different this go around. Looking at Uncharted. Now, this movie is still in theater, so this is a cam version of a movie. So, don't kill me. Don't kill me.
You shouldn't have come out to play with a big boys, Ian, because you're about to get a proper Scottish welcome.
I'm sorry.
All right, so the scene with the Scottish fellow taking and coming after Tom Holland's character is one of my favorite scenes in the whole movie. I mean, it's early into him and into Nate and Sully's relationship, their first time really having any experience together, working with each other, and this big old Scottish fella comes after Nathan Drake, and of course, him speaking as fast as he doesn't catch anything this cat's saying to him. So the ensuing fight that happens, just number one, brilliant bit of distraction work, I should say. Now, granted, you're not going to take and see all of this at the moment because, well, copyright. However, at this point, he's already met Antonio Banderas, Moncada fella. So, this being one of Braddock's goons. The fact that, she's so suave looking, like just killer, and then this big old Scottish speaking feller, I don't know, it just sets such a contrast once, especially for this fight scene.
That's it. You shouldn't come into play with our camp boys. We ain't done about to get a bumper stutter.
Of course, he's not gonna understand what he's saying. He got a big fella trying to speak Scottish to him. He's like, the hell?
I literally have no idea what you're saying.
I'll get this to where it belongs. Good luck.
Chloe has the other cross.
What?
Did I not mention that?
No, you didn't.
Are you sure? Well, look, it's mine, basically, all right? Okay. So we're all going to be partners on this thing. That's the way it's happening, so get used to it.
No, we're not.
One of the things I love about the introduction of Chloe into this is the fact that, number one, you start seeing just how, untrustworthy Sully is, just a wee bit. And it also, introduction to her into the dynamic also shows just how cutthroat the treasure hunting business is, and just how much double crossing there is by the fact that the first thing she does is double cross and take the cross. So, yeah.
Toast. All right. Arriba,
bajo, al centro, y por dentro. I'd be done, spiked their stuff and took the crosses and skedaddled.
¿Verdad que no tienes fe que pueda valerme por mí mismo?
En él tengo fe.
I'd say this, Antonio Banderas has plays just as well of a good guy as he does a bad guy.
Santiago, ¿qué estás haciendo? Perdóname, padre.
Now he can do what he wants, I guess. I think the scenes with Antonio Banderas in this movie are some of the ones that... Number one, it's established before Antonio Banderas even comes into the scene, the Moncadas, who the crosses are supposed to belong to, and feel double-crossed. And then you see him, and he's at an auction, and he's trying to take him by the cross. And then you see scenes with his father, and it shows very clearly that Antonio Banderas' character very much trying to... I don't know if it's so much as trying to gain his father's approval as much as he's trying to, bring new life to an old way, an old family. And his way of doing so is getting these crosses and replacing or basically rebuilding the family's wealth. And it gets to the point where the disagreement and the way him and his dad feel, with his dad talking about giving away all of the family fortune, he kills his dad. And that kind of, this whole movie almost, it feels like the whole theme is nothing but, trust nobody and double crosses. So he double crosses, basically, he kills his dad, which is, it's double crossing of the entire family, pretty much. And it goes directly from that to our three capers, Chloe, Sully, Nathan, in the church, where they've, the church and the tree. So now they're all, there's no honor among thieves, but apparently they can collaborate and work together for a common cause before they take and double cross each other. And so you've got the affirmations throughout this movie of double crossing. The building of the Moncada, not only within the storytelling at the beginning, so you get affirmations all the way throughout of just how important it is to this family, and Antonio Banderas' character being basically the manifestation of the frustrations and wanting to rebuild that wealth through a treasure that's supposed to be his family's, and him ultimately double-crossing his dad by taking and killing him, and immediately it switches over to the three who, for the most part, it's all about double-crossing, so...
Never thought I'd be back in church, but this one's special.
Hey, Sully.
What?
This scene right here where Nathan finds the postcards, and clearly one of them is the same postcard that his brother has sent to him. And it's at this point you start getting maybe a little bit of an inkling, if you hadn't already, at how important the postcards that his brother Sam sent to him after he was left at the orphanage. Because he at least notices, oh, wow, well, my brother was here too, so he's about to say something to Sully and then ultimately doesn't. But it's the beginning of something that comes into play later on down the line in the movie.
Look.
J.S.E. Juan Sebastian Alcano.
18, well, you're all right. Look, if that's the cathedral, then these must be the stairs. And they lead that way.
One of the things past him, Sully giving Nate the books and everything like that, the captain's log, let him go through it. This scene right here, I think is one of those affirmations, one of those things that shows just how the inquisitive mind and the working out of things, and how Nathan is really, not only because it's based on a video game, we all know that this is based on a video game, but just how key he is to figuring out the puzzle that leads them to where they need to go to find the Moncada, to find the treasure of the 18. This right here, him taking tracing out and pointing the way that they need to go to further find what they're looking for.
Holy shit, you found him.
Wait, which way should we turn, that's right?
I don't know. What does the book say?
All right, here. Both of you turn your keys clockwise at the same time.
3, 2, 1.
Turn.
I absolutely love this part of the movie because it further cements just how much Sully relies on everybody else and how much he tries to fake it till he makes it. I mean, which way to turn? It says turn clockwise. Clearly showing before it's pointed out that he apparently cannot read Latin. He cannot read what's in that journal. So they all almost take and get skewered after they take and turn things clockwise. Like, oh my goodness. This was one, this right here, some of the little, for me, this movie is as much about the little parts that take and give away, basically point to the bigger picture and the bigger subplots that are going on within the film itself. The way they've done this is just, in my opinion, it's very sly the way they take and do it, but it's also very, very neat because it seems like little humorous points of movies, or it's just something little, you know, of the movie, or something that's just seems small, seems like, you know, well, okay, that's interesting, but it ties back to the subplot points of the bigger picture of the movie and themes that run throughout it. So this right here being a keen example of showing just how basically vulnerable Sully is, and how he's pretty much, he has the money, basically. He has money to take and back these treasure things, these treasure and artifact hunting. And he's a little bit knowledgeable, like he knows lore, but ultimately he relies on other people. And this is a very good showcase of that here.
What with you? Tinder? Really?
I own that.
Okay. Now you can track us. Try and stay on top of us, okay?
There you go. Have fun in the haunted tunnel.
Yeah.
Enjoy.
Oh, we will.
This is another one of those scenes that it seems, number one, it injects humor. But it goes back and it takes and reinforces the point of, number one, not trusting, because he didn't want to take and give over his phone. And leading up to this, he had a problem with Drake going down into the tunnel with Chloe. But it reinforces that sub theme within the movie of mistrust and double crossing, because it's the first thing that popped to his mind is about double crossing. And they're going to double cross him. Even though both crosses are going to be needed, it's that much mistrust. And it's these little affirmations within pieces of comedy that they can tie back into the bigger subplots and the bigger subpoints throughout the movie itself that I really think they did a good job on. Because really, a lot of folks, they're going to watch it, they're going to take and enjoy the movie for what it is. But the subtext and stuff like that, they further reinforce as you're taking and watching subconsciously what you're seeing on screen. And it's just that whole thing of there's no trust amongst basically thieves. No honor, no trust amongst the thieves. Even though they've taken and teamed up, double crossing can happen at any moment. So this little bit of scenes right here between them going into the rave from the underground tunnels to noticing that Braddock's people are there, and then having to take and basically fight at the very end as they figure out, you know, as a girl figures out Eye of Horus, crap, this is where the key goes and everything of that nature. One of the things that's, number one, it shows the ingenuity that's needed at this point to take and get out of certain sticky situations whenever gunplay might be involved and, you know, some fighting with the baddies. It's, you know, it's not really action. It's not a whole lot of action at this point, but it takes and kind of, it's that little bit of bump that's needed to kind of provide a little bit more drama, because at this point you kind of hit a lull because they're looking from above and below, from above where Sully's at and below, to take and see exactly where this, where these crosses are pointing to. And so this is a nice little bit of a bumper. It's a nice little bit of bumper to take and move things along, add a little bit of drama without taking anything away from the story, but while also subconsciously entering another subpoint, because how do Braddock's people, why are they there? Why are they in this same spot that they are at the same time? How do they know they're there? And that's a subplot point that really, if you're not thinking about it, because all you're going to be like, oh crap, they're there. If you're not thinking about it, that's one of those things that's like, you know, oh crap, they, you know, that Braddock's people are looking, so, you know, they've went to this club, but why are they in this club? So subconsciously, unless you're thinking about this kind of thing, really, you're not going to take and think about it. It's just going to be one of those cool little parts in the movie where there's a little bit of action that kind of bolsters everything along.
I think I found one.
I almost caught up.
You got that key?
Yeah. Now they're going to be able to get two keys at once. Think this scene right here, not only taking and injecting even more drama past where they've just gotten out of the sight of Braddock's men after that little bit of skirmish there, this little bit right here adds a little bit more drama, but also reinforces the fact and it shows why two keys are needed, because they've got the one, and all that's done now is basically put them in a position where they can drown, which no bueno. Got Sully up top, so now the importance of them working together and having both keys really comes into play.
All we've been through.
Sully! Hurry! Here! Stop! What's going on? Chloe!
I love the bit of double drama that they took and put in this scene, because not only do you have Nate and Chloe down there, water rising, basically fighting for their lives, trying to figure a way out with all the water that's coming in, but you got Sully basically fighting for his and kind of their lives over that cross after Braddock finds him in the pizza shop. So you got a sense of double drama and just a handful of small scenes that take and flash through right here, right? And it sets up not only the length at which, number one, they're looking for this cross. Number two, the importance, reinforcing the importance of both crosses, having both crosses, because you need one, you need to have both. One, if you only have one and you're in a particular spot, like if you're just down there in the catacombs, you don't have somebody up top, well, you're going to take and drown. So now Sully's taking and fighting for his life, and he's trying to take and get to where he can actually use that key, because Nate and Chloe's life hang in the balance as well. So there's a nice little bit of double drama that they've got going on here. There might not be any honor amongst thieves, but collaboration together can get you to your goal. And, well, if something happens to the other two, he's at a dead end again. He's start back square one. I think this scene right here kind of reinforces the fact that Nathan Drake isn't like Sully or the rest of the people that he's having to associate himself with right now. This is more than an adventure for him. This is fulfilling something that him and his brother had planned long ago as kids. He in the beginning of the movie, he does love to bracelet off of a girl. It's more of as a means of, I think, entertainment for him than it is a way of life. It's something that, you know, it's just innate with him. Whereas these cats, the double crossing and stuff like that. So him going back down for Chloe shows the side that the rest of the people in this movie, whether it be the villains or even Sully at this point, that what you might take and give them credit for. So it's a nice little nod of, like, subconsciously, as you know, because up to this point we've seen Moncada's father, you know, old man Moncada take and die. So it's one of those nods of, like, it's a little bit different, just a little bit. So, no honor among thieves, but this thief is a little bit different.
Chloe, please tell me what happened to your brother.
You're a good guy, eh?
So this scene right here, this is where not only does Chloe double cross him and Sully, but she places the impetus on what happened to Sam, Nate's brother, on Sully, and gives kind of the, at least him, the opening salvo of more interest of, hey, everything is not what it seems. There's the deception at play here on all parts. So, you know, she tells him he's too good, but needs to ask Sully what happened to Nate, or what happened to Sam. So this is, again, it reinforces a couple different things as far as the subplots in this movie with the mistrust, the double-crossing, and overall dishonesty that's amongst this cast of characters.
Where's Sam, Sully?
I should have told you before. But your brother, he's gone, kid.
No, he's not. You said he ghosted you.
He's gone. He didn't ghost me.
So this bit right here, the confrontation with Sully over what happened to Sam and him finally coming clean about everything, it's a definitely changes dynamic going forward between these two. And I think it kind of reinforces what he already knew about Sully and the people that, you know, this whole expedition that he's going on and the people that not only he's worked with up to this point, Sully and Chloe, but as far as what he's up against as well, if he continues on, because, spoiler here, Braddock takes and kills Sam. So it's, I think this is one of those parts of a movie that ultimately, it's as much character development as it is the story development, taking giving more the backstory. And the way they take and drop the backstory of what's happened, at least to set the scene for the start of the franchise, because make no mistake, this, the Uncharted series is going to be a franchise. It's just, there's too many good stories that can be written, whether they based completely off the video game stories themselves, or if they take and bring in and write their own stories for Nathan Drake, like little parts they could actually turn into video games later on as like side stories that happen in between the main video games. I mean, that's a very big possibility. And it's, I think stuff like this, as far as the development, not only story-wise, taking and filling in blanks, but also character development, because realization happening here, truth being told, a little bit of honesty, finally, and now, of course, you're going to see anger and everything like that, but the drive past this is also has changed his perspective on things a little bit as far as how he goes forward. So,
Miss Chloe Fraser, my people are out looking for her.
Oh, yeah. You mean big guy, doesn't talk, and sidekick, the Highlander? Yeah, they didn't find me.
Diversified investment. I hired his Fraser the same day I hired you.
Now you see this this part right here. So this be a nice little bit of plot twist, but it takes and explains the reason why Braddock and her men were able to take and find Chloe and Drake where they were. It's also the reason why, it also explains the reasoning behind why probably Braddock was able to find Sully so quickly. There's an inside man. So it's one of those things where it could be a nice plot twist right there in the middle, but also the subtle signs towards it have already been there, and this is just tying those pieces together for that little bit of plot twist that if you're paying attention, you're thinking about it, you're going to take and work out as soon as you see her there. So really, really neat in my opinion, the way they took and did that.
I'm going to finish what my brother started, and then we go our separate ways.
All right. It's a deal, kid.
So this scene right here where basically Sully comes in and he tells him, hey, look, you know, I know they're about to take and leave out. I know they're at, you know, Chloe was working for them and everything like that. And Drake at this point has already made up his mind that he's going to take and see this thing through, but not because of Sully or any riches that might be involved, but more the fact of is something that him and his brother, beginning of the movie, something they had planned on pursuing themselves. So he's already started it. He's going to take and see it through. And he just lays his cards on the table. And again, it takes in, it's a not only a pivot point for the story as far as Drake is concerned with his mindset going forward, but also kind of a flipping a little bit of Sully and his personality. So you've got a little bit of character development, and you've got more dynamic, another dynamic within the aspect of the relationship between Drake and Sully. So again, it's another nice little piece, nice little way they took and did this as far as the story is concerned.
500 years ago, my family was betrayed. Found the world's biggest their fortune. And you know what? They hid it. It was left to me.
To not really you, but the people that you hired.
Is the day I restore the Mulcara's fortune. And I bring honor back to my house. And I earn my place in...
This one scene right here, I think, is really the ultimate culmination of number one, what greed happens, just blind greed, because as much as he says it's taken to restore his family's honor, it's also basically for the money. $5-6 billion valuation in today's currency. So he's taken and hired all these shifty, shady people to take a work under him, basically to find this fortune, forgetting the fact that they're artifact and, you know, they're treasure hunters and artifact hunters and explorers themselves. And all of them very shady. So he's been in command up to this point. But the slitting of the throat, basically the thank you for financing this operation here, basically the final blow to the Moncada legacy, since he's done killed his father, who had planned on giving away the Moncada fortune. Had his father killed. So everything comes full circle at this point. So all his visions of grandeur and everything like that, wanting to take and restore his family name, get all this money, restore the family's fortune, all for naught. Because as the saying goes, what goes around comes around, and it definitely comes back around to him.
Hey! Did you kill my brother? I said, did you kill my brother, Sam Drake? Hey, come on!
I do have to say, as much as I enjoy some of the action scenes in this, number one, shooting in an airplane. Like, that's one of the great things about Hollywood, and one of the great things about movies, is things happen in movies that would never happen in real life. So fanciful. However, this part right here, basically confronting his brother's killer, and this is really the impetus for the scene that you see in the trailers of him taking and jumping from pallet to pallet, basically, and dodging them and everything like that, basically starts right here. So it's his way of taking and getting that affirmation of, yes, you are the person that killed my brother, Sam. It leads to a lot of fanciful stuff, some of which I'll take and clip in, possibly, but yeah.
Thanks. Oh,
come on!
So we've got Chloe here. Again, she's watched Braddock take and kill Moncada. Now, Braddock's looking at killing her, calling her loose end and stuff like that. So, of course, she's going to make her bit of escape. Again, more of the fanciful fighting stuff. But it makes this part that, you know, other than the twist of basically killing Moncada, bumps up the adrenaline a little bit, takes and bumps up the drama of the situation, and really just, it makes for nice viewing. Enjoyed it a whole lot, and I think they did a really good job of the choreography of everything within this.
If you did try to tell me something, cast it in these cards. Oh God, did you try to tell me something, Sam?
Is it something in the images?
Or something in the writing?
And this right here is where the importance of those postcards that Sam sent to him finally come into focus. And it's a nice tie back to not only the beginning of the story itself, but also shows the importance of him kind of looking and realizing, okay, my brother's been to all these places already when they were there at the church in Barcelona. So this little bit of tie-in right here plays very nicely, and it's more story, basically tying up ends that were left a little bit frayed and some unanswered questions.
Who goes there? I got Chloe. Okay.
Another thing right here, tying up an end that begins, it shows with the having to take heat up underneath, showing the hidden message. Something him and his brother did, the way they took and communicated when they were younger. Again, tying back the way they take and do that throughout this movie and hearken to it. Really, just really cool.
Sorry, Nate. I like you. I really do. But I learned the hard way the minute you start to trust someone, you lose.
Yeah, well, too bad you're headed in the wrong direction.
So at this point, he already knows you can't trust anybody. He figured, if he took and set out the wrong coordinates, that she would take and more than likely leave, and she wouldn't actually look any further and see the actual coordinates he'd hidden in a bottle, message in a bottle. Another, it's one of the adventure tropes, adventure movie and adventure game type tropes. So that right there, him taking and actually not so much double crossing as giving the wrong information, because it's already an uneasy alliance. She's double crossed him already once before, so him setting her up to take and actually go in the wrong direction, just really more affirmation of, you know, not number one, character development. It's more character development because it shows his growth as not only seeing, hey, this is how things operate, so this is what I'm going to do, but also the way he took and actually found the coordinates and then wrote out the two different sets, the fake ones and the real ones, and now she's taking the bait.
Lost. Not gone. There's a difference. If something's lost, it can be found.
Another one of those nice tie-ins to his brother, because this is something that his brother said at the beginning of the movie. So tying everything back to Sam and tying a lot of things back to the beginning. So the movie, a lot of times, and this movie, it comes full circle quite a few times. And whether it be in his life, or whether it be, you know, Moncada getting killed, or the whole circle of distrust and double crossing, like there's multiple times that the circle comes, you know, everything goes full circle in this movie. And the way all the subtext and the subplots and everything else like that play together and really tie in and drive quite a few points home if you take and pay attention to everything that's going on up underneath the hood. Really, I'm more impressed with this movie as I take and have started actually editing it than whenever I was actually doing the full recording to it or the full reaction to it. So I think this is another one of those situations where everything is kind of tied back and re-strengthened and just points to that foundation that was set at the beginning of the movie.
I found the gold.
I don't see any gold.
Always here. It falls top. Oh, pirate ship. Here's your gold you've been looking for. You happy now?
Son, we did it! We actually did it!
Sonny, we didn't do anything. Okay, there is no we. There's only you. Because there's not a person in your life that you wouldn't betray for a piece of this. You made that real clear.
I thought that's what we wanted.
No, I wanted to do this with my brother Sam. Not with you.
So this is one of those parts in the movie that really, I think, more impactful as far as the character development of Sully than what really any other point in the movie, because he's faced with the bare facts of not only how his actions have done, because he's clearly excited at this point. They've done it. They found the gold, and Nate's like, nah, this is all you. This is what you wanted. This isn't what I wanted. I want to do it with somebody else. Basically, you sell your own mom for a piece of gold. So this, it's one of those reckoning moments within a movie for a specific character in their development arc.
I know. I'm sorry. I look around, kid. You did this.
Sorry!
I think this scene right here shows just how much impact the number one, all the double crossing, the Drake holding Sully responsible ultimately for Sam's death, his greed and everything like that. This is part of that development arc right here for character development, where you see he's like, he lets go of the gold. He lets go of the gold, knowing full well there's a good possibility he doesn't have any gold left. Because that pack is full of it. So, knocks her off and saves Drake this go-around instead of, like, with his brother at the beginning.
Can you hear me? I can't now. I was just saying we should get out of here. Yeah, I might let her see the wrong coordinates.
How's that?
Too soon? Forever too soon.
Yeah, maybe this will help. I got you something.
All right, so you're gonna get basically two different conclusions. I'm giving you one right here. I enjoyed the movie. I really did. I think, especially once going back through and actually doing the editing, so I could add enough commentary or critique, because that's one thing a lot of people take and say about reactions is, oh, you're just taking and watching something and using. But the thing is, really doing it properly, you're more like a video journalist, because at this point, not a lot of people take and go to websites to read stuff. They take and go to YouTube to get somebody's opinion on a video. You know, they get people's opinion on what they thought of it. This is just showing little clips and giving my opinion of those clips that I'm taking and showing. And really, this movie, as I've went through and started taking and I started editing and really paying a little bit more attention, especially in the clips that I showed, just some of the threads that taken emerged, like the whole everything being brought back full circle, the underlying theme of mistrust, Drake's basically, you know, as far as his brother is concerned, his brother who is, he's shown at the beginning and then he's an entity throughout the entire movie, even though he's basically an invisible entity, but he's a driving factor for Drake. So the way they made his basically appearance, they just showed him at the beginning and then he was still an entity throughout the movie itself without having to take and be on camera whatsoever. I think the way they took and did that was really clever and is really just tying a lot of things back to him, and then at the end of it, full circle, because he's sitting there, he's still alive, so, you know, hopefully nobody is going to get too many spoilers on this, but really, I enjoyed this, I really did. Now, granted, there are a lot of normal adventure tropes in this, but I think the way that they took and played off of those tropes, and they held a couple of subplots in there, a couple of plot twists that, again, go back to the whole playing things full circle, taking it actually, like, as far as Braddock finding them, you know, her goons finding them in the underground rave club, and then Braddock herself finding Sully there up top, and the fact that Chloe was an inside person for the whole operation, since she had also been hired along with Braddock to take and help find the keys, the way that the keys take and play a role. Got to have both. Well, to take and have both, even with there being no honor among thieves, leads to collaborations, uneasy alliances, and the double crossing that happens from there, and the double crossing being a theme throughout the entirety of the movie itself. Just, I think it's a really well put together movie. I really do. The more I take and actually have looked at it, I think it's Sully for his part. Like, read a lot of reviews where people were talking about, oh, character development. There wasn't a whole lot of character development. Didn't like the way Sully was portrayed, or the fact that Nathan Drake was portrayed by Tom Holland. And to be honest with you, for a video game movie, sometimes I think they have to take and go with some bigger names. Granted, if they'd went with some smaller names whose acting chops might not have been up to par, I don't think maybe that you'd have had some of the same kind of comedic effects, and also I don't think some of the subplots would have worked as well. Same thing with Antonio Banderas being, you know, as far as the Moncadas are concerned. So character development, just under 2 hour runtime, is hard to take and get full on character development. This is more of you take and going to get character development, I think, throughout a series of movies itself. Character development did occur during the course of this movie. It was very subtle in the way that it was presented and the way that you've seen it, because you've seen Sully starting off as a very egotistical and very greedy and self-centered. And by the end of the movie, after the come to Jesus moment with Nathan Drake, he takes and forgoes the gold, saves Drake, and is rewarded at the end for a little bit of character development with the gold that Drake has gotten for him. You've got Drake himself starting off. It shows him as a kid, and then it jumps forward after him and his brother caught at the trying to take the Magellan's map, and he goes from being a naive, basically street savvy pickpocket to an adventurer who's also naive but learns throughout that basically him and his brother are the compass that he needs. There's no need to take and double cross unless it's absolutely necessary, while learning that, you know, double crossing is the way of things, and eventually basically, you know, showing that he's, even though he's in this thing, he has a better moral compass than the rest of them. He goes from a very naive kid to a lot more smart, and a full-on adventurer at the same time. So I think the character development was small, and it only happened really with the main characters of Sully and Drake. Moncada, he got his just desserts. You know, he's egotistical, he's driven, he seems to have daddy issues with the fact that, you know, looking for dad's approval. Dad doesn't like him, doesn't trust him, is going to take and completely give away what's remaining of the Moncada fortune, so he kills daddy off. Well, he's hired less than savory people, and what happens to him? Well, everything comes full circle, and, well, he's taken out by the same person that he hired to take out his daddy and also find the keys. The keys being the driving point, got to have two, and I think that's representative of, you know, the theme of this movie. Even though you don't trust somebody, you need help to take and get things accomplished. So really, there's a lot of things at play here. I think the way they did it was for the most part, well done. I enjoyed it. I think it's even with all the tropes and everything else like that, really, really enjoyable movie. So if you want to see the full movie reaction, have taken, join my channel membership, and the link will be in the member exclusive videos. So, all right. So this ran on a ton of action adventure tropes, but well acted by Tom Holland, Mark Wahlberg, Antonio Banderas. Like, anytime you see him in a movie, you always enjoy his presence in the movie. His presence, like, just the thought of his presence and the character he played a larger role in the movie than he himself did. Especially after he's taken out, you see Braddock is the real threat of the in the film. Little plot twist there. I mean, it's with all the double crossers, you kind of figured that maybe Antonio Banderas' character's not going to make it to the end. But, you know, being a big-name actor, figure maybe they're not going to take him out. Do anyways. Just, I don't know. The whole development of the characters within the movie itself, there wasn't a whole lot other than with Sully taking actually giving up the gold for the first time after allowing Sam, his brother, to die. Nate's brother to die. The girl, you know, she took... cracked him in the head with a gun. That led to him taking and figuring out. She still double crosses regardless. You know, it's not a bad movie whatsoever. I mean, because the whole run through Barcelona and the Roman antechambers and stuff like that, and the water scene. A lot of a lot of parts in it that take keep the movie moving in a way and keeps it interesting enough, even though the story itself, it really, like Clive Cussler has done stories like this with Dirk Pitt and everything like that in the books and even in Sahara and other movies and stuff. So, I mean, it's not like it's, like I said, you don't have to reinvent the wheel. And they didn't, but they put enough in this to make it entertaining enough to actually, you know, be enjoyable, which is really cool. Because a lot of movies these days, they just don't catch my interest. And this one, if not for Mark Wahlberg and Tom Holland in the first 15, 20 minutes of it, I probably would have turned it off, to be honest with you. But it got better as it went. I enjoyed it. So, and there to cut at the credit, right before the credits, sets up for a second one with the brother still being alive, which again plays into video game lore and stuff like that. So the way that, you know, they did twist some things as far as how the video games are concerned, but, you know, the fact that there towards the last one, him and his brother were taken and actually, and I mean, so it's a lot of nice video game tie-ins, a lot of nice, it sets the scene for a nice movie franchise. I mean, it really does. And I tell you what, with Tom Holland supposedly taking a year off or so from acting, so he can focus more on, I guess, starting a family with Zendaya, or at least taking and just, you know, enjoying himself and relaxing a little bit before he really goes back hard and heavy into things or starts acting again, gets time for both the Spider-Man franchises, which he's Spider-Man in, and it takes and gives enough time for the franchise, for this franchise, get a little bit of age on himself as far as looks are concerned, because he'll need both. Kind of really the way that everything is playing out between the movies, and probably I could see 2 years from now another movie, maybe 3 years, another movie from this, another movie from the Spider-Man, another three-part Spider-Man phase, hopefully bringing in Miles Morales and shit like that. Like, kind of sets everything up perfectly.
Are you done?
No, give me a sec. 1 sec. Finishing. So, really, I enjoyed this, and more movies to come, so y'all be good to each other, love yourselves. Peace.